Rick Martin. I'm the chief of operations at the park, and this is just outstanding to see people who are interested in this. I wanted to tell you a little bit about this. This particular program that has been about 2 years in the making, and there was a grant from the Lower Mississippi Delta Initiative that actually started this. And this was actually Superintendent Mayer's brainchild. We were kind of talking, and what we wanted to do was get a codified program for guides and also incorporate the city involved in this. So we got a hold of Bill Surratt and talked with him about it. And then Jeff Gambrone, where are you at, Jeff?
Right
in front of you. This gentleman right here, he and his partner, Hap Owen, developed the guide program, the study guide. And then they contacted General Parker Hills, and he's going to lead us through the seminar. And like I said, it's been a long process to come up to this point, and I'm really excited to see what's going to happen. We're hoping, I know there's people here just for informational purposes, but we're hoping that we're going to get some more guides out of this. And there are a lot of guides here right now, too, that are here getting refreshed, I think, and I plan on sitting in as many programs as I can, too. But I want to welcome everybody here. If you're not familiar with the area, when you exit the door, the front door, and to your right, those are the restrooms. There's a drinking fountain out there right now. I don't think we're going to be here too long tonight, but we're going to talk about, you know, bringing snacks and things like that. If you want to do that, I'll leave that up to General Hills. I will ask you as a courtesy, if you check your phones right now and put them on silent or meeting or whatever, so we're not interrupted with all that, and I have to do the same thing. And we'll turn it over to General Hills and let him take off with this. And sir, you're going to introduce yourself, I hope.
I am.
That's good.
Yep, why don't you stand up and say hello, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Hi. Good evening, folks.
Good evening.
All right, I like that. Jeff Gambrone and Hap Owen, as Rick mentioned to you, have developed the tour guide manual that folks are responsible for the ads you saw in the newspaper, and most of you are here because of that reason. It's a very professional organization. It's a pleasure to be able to have a chance to work with them. So it's a concerted effort on a lot of people's part to put this thing on as we start working along. And we actually sat down, I guess, about 4 months ago before all of this was figured out, how are we going to work this? And I sat down and decided to make this happen. I'll show you a little video here, a little PowerPoint on what I do and what Battle Focus is all about. And then we'll get into this program right quick. And tonight will be just an introduction. Let you know what to expect for the next few weeks as we go through this, this entire campaign. And it's going to be like drinking from a fire hose, but I want to make it as enjoyable as possible as we go through this. So let's take a look here.
Thank you.
a quote from General U.S. Grant. And before I tell you the circumstances, I think you understand the time of it. It's 1879 when he says this. He's going around the world with his wife on a two-year trip. They go to Jerusalem and walk the Stations of the Cross. They go to India. They go to Egypt. They run into William Wayne Loring, a former Confederate general who's the military advisor to the Khedive of Egypt. And Grant has his photograph taken with General Loring in front of the Great Pyramid. There's a reporter that goes along on this trip. His name is John Russell Young. And he writes a two-volume work called Around the World with General Grant. It's a fairly rare book. It took me a few years to find copies of it. And as I read the two volumes, I realized that there really wasn't a lot in there until you get to the back of the second volume, unless you just want to be a tourist and find out what it's like to be in Israel or be in Egypt or whatever. But I am convinced that what happened with Grant was this. He got on the fantail of the boat after Julia had gone to bed, his wife, and she didn't let him drink. He got on the fantail of the boat, and she's gone to bed, until the reporter slips him a snifter of brandy and a good cigar, probably a Cuban. And Grant gets on the back of the boat, and he's sipping and smoking, and he gets a little loose-lipped. And he starts being very candid with this reporter and saying things that really are illuminating as we look at it 150 years later. And he says this, I don't think that there's one of my campaigns with which I have not some fault to find, except Vicksburg. I don't know how I could have improved that. He says, I don't see how I could have improved the Vicksburg campaign. Now, I grew up here in Mississippi, and I was always taught that Grant just got lucky. Or that he had more men and more whatever. And as I began to grow up and go soldiering and studying this campaign, it dawned on me that you make your own luck. And this is a masterful campaign. It's a wonderful campaign to study. Particularly as I like to train soldiers and Marines still, on thinking strategically, the big picture. This is a marvelous campaign for thinking big, thinking at the national level, thinking how to maneuver an army, thinking the political problems that go about soldiering as you're trying to accomplish your goals. This is a masterful campaign. So we'll be studying this campaign over the next few weeks. Grant later wrote in his memoirs in 1885, as he's dying of throat cancer from all those cigars he started smoking back in 1862 at Fort Donelson, when Henry Holfoot gave him the cigar and he put down his mission pipe and tried one out, then he starts smoking 12 a day for the rest of his life, and he dies of throat cancer in 1885. But he writes in his memoirs, the fate of the Confederacy was sealed when Vicksburg fell. Now that should tell you something. When a man who becomes a commanding general of all U.S. armies writes that in his memoirs 20 years later. Now that kind of goes against the grain of what we've always been taught as school kids. That's, we all know that the whole Civil War was fought around Washington, D.C. and Richmond, Virginia. Ask any Eastern Theater guy. The war was all Virginia. And of course, Gettysburg, the 1st through the 3rd of July, 1863. That is the turning point of the Civil War. If you Google Gettysburg, the Battle of Gettysburg, or Wikipedia, that's what it'll tell you. Right today. The turning point of the Civil War. Now, I just got through this spring conducting four tours in April and May in Gettysburg, and I love going to Gettysburg. And I had an opportunity to take a bunch of wounded veterans or wounded soldiers from Walter Reed Army Medical Center up there, and made what a great honor. And I love going to Gettysburg. But there's a big difference between Gettysburg and this Vicksburg campaign. Now look at the Vicksburg campaign. Look at the dates I'm giving you. From the 6th of February, 1862 to the 4th of July, 1863. That's a long period. And we're going to cover that over these next 7 weeks. What happened there? Because if you don't understand what happened, how the armies and the navies got here, they didn't beam in, they got here. They came here for a reason. And they got here through a method to the madness. So we'll take a look at that and see how they do this over the next few weeks. Now, we saw this one boom for Gettysburg for 3 days. Take a look at the Vicksburg campaign during that period of time. Started out good for him at Fort Henry and Donelson, but boy, it fell apart on him in a hurry. But he learned a lot of lessons, and he applied them in 1863 down here in Mississippi and in Louisiana. One key point. At Gettysburg, as you can see, Robert E. Lee's army marched out away from Gettysburg and went back to Virginia. After Gettysburg, two armies left Gettysburg. After Vicksburg, the Federals moved in to Vicksburg, and the Confederate Army here ceased to exist. One army was eliminated. All of its weaponry, all of its cannons, all of its rank, all of this went. The lieutenant general who commanded this army became a lieutenant colonel, because that's the only job they had for him. There was no army for him. So he rode a desk for the rest of the war in Richmond, Virginia. There's a huge difference. Also, notice in the Vicksburg campaign, we have joint operations. We have the formation of a brown water navy that operates on these shallow rivers out here. These boats drawing 6 feet of water. Invented, engineered for this specific purpose. You cannot talk about the Vicksburg campaign without talking about the Navy, so we'll have some fun doing that too. And of course, we have the Cabral here. Wow! Only one left in the world we've got here at Vicksburg. Of course, that's the Arkansas in July of 62. But after Vicksburg fell, take a look at your map here. The whole lower Mississippi Valley now belongs to the north. And just as importantly, the western side of the Mississippi River is now out of touch with the rest of the Confederacy. All of the beef, all of the lead, all of the salt, all the manpower, all the saltpeter, all of the things that you need to prosecute a war is lost to the rest of the Confederacy. Not counting the geographic nature of the state of Texas, most of Louisiana, Arkansas, Missouri. Gone. This was such a critical campaign, and it came at a point in time where the president needed a win so badly. President Lincoln. He came this close. If you can't see my fingers, I got about a millimeter between my forefinger and my thumb to losing this war politically. In early 1863 and late 62. And we'll talk about that also. All right, let's talk quickly about the seminar. We've got two missions. Number one, to produce licensed battlefield guides for Vicksburg National Military Park. Clearly, We need licensed battlefield guys here. And we don't just need licensed battlefield guys, we need very well-educated licensed battlefield guys. We want them to be super professional. We've got some great professional guys now, but we just don't have enough. And if we do our job right, we will increase tourism in this area where we'll need a lot more guys. We're working on that in a lot of other ways, too. Number two, if you don't want to be a licensed battlefield guide, just to create public awareness of the Vicksburg campaign, because I promise you we'll lose the public relations battle with Gettysburg. Thousands upon thousands of books are written on Gettysburg, and you can probably, ones are worth reading, one hand's worth from Vicksburg. One's worth reading, I see. We need to get more folks down here. We've got the resources. We have these marvelous battlefields out there. We haven't even marked yet this campaign. Once we get into this military park, that's the end of the campaign. We'll end it up here. But you got to see the rest of it, too. These are the seminar sessions, the dates of them, and you've got your calendar, your schedule. I three-hole punched it for you. I recommend you go to Walmart and get you one of those Buck 98 three-ring binders. Every week, I will give you an outline of what we're going to do, and there will be three-hole punch ready for you to go. I've even got a couple of boxes of ink pens for those of you who are too cheap to buy one. So get your own binders, all right? Whatever makes you feel, clipboard, whatever you feel comfortable with to take your notes, and we'll look at this. We're going to meet every Tuesday night starting on the 23rd, about 2 weeks from tonight. Thought I'd give you a breather, a chance to really, you know, get your blood going, ready to go out and kill something and eat it 2 weeks from now. Okay? So that's September the 23rd through November the 4th, seven nights. I say 12 sessions because many of these nights will count as two sessions. We'll go from 6:30 to 8 for our one session and 6:30 to 9 for our two sessions. Now I'll try to get you out of here a little before 9 o'clock if I can. I got to drive back to Clinton, and some of y'all got to do the same thing. So there's no, but you know, we've got a lot of material to cover, and I'm not going to short sheet you on any of it. I'll make sure you get as much as I can possibly get. And please understand something. This campaign, studying this campaign, is still a work in progress. There are things that we're still uncovering. Locations and facts and things out there. Mysteries of this campaign. That's why it's so complex. It makes it so much fun to study. We'll have some fun looking into some of these things. We'll meet right here. Every time we meet, Vicksburg National Military Park and Auditorium. You see our marvelous waterfront mural down at the Vicksburg waterfront of the CSS Arkansas. The Cairo, which didn't really happen, but that's a different story. But it's a good painting! It's a great painting! You know? So I looked at that and I photographed it off of the wall. I didn't even see the bricks up here. And I said, you know what? This shows the city of Vicksburg. It shows the Navy. It shows all what it's about. So why don't we use that as the background for our graduation certificate? So for those of you who complete the seminar, you'll get a really nifty, ready for framing graduation certificate that you can hang on your I Love Me wall. And the next time you're writing a resume, which we in the military call a puff piece, you can have that in your file. You say, you know, I am a graduate of the Vicksburg Military Seminar, Vicksburg Campaign Seminar, and I am now a subject matter expert. Whatever you want to know, ask me. You got at least a 9 out of 10 chance of getting the correct answer. 10% got the bovine scatology. You're free for that, okay? Also, for those of you who complete the requirements and want to become a tour guide, Jeff has written up a magnificent tour guide manual. With the history of the town, the history of the campaign, the iconography of all the sculptures in the park. All, I mean, it is something. He's going to put the bookstore out of business. Because in this guide manual is, and I've got a draft copy of it, as an old trigonometry teacher used to say, rat chew. Miss Willie Spann, boy, she taught a mean trick class. Rat cheer. So one day she went out in the hallway and I got up and I drew a rat and a box of cheer on the chalkboard. And she came in and she pointed right up to the sine and the cosine and she looked up and she saw that. She says, Parker Hills, get up here! I said, Miss Spann, how do you know I did it? She says, you're the only one in my class that can draw. You should know better than that. 2 weeks of trigonometry detention, that's tough. But this is a beautiful, beautiful manual. I think you'll really enjoy this when you get a chance to go through that. For those of you who also complete the requirements, we will have 3 field trips in early December. November the 15th, December the 6th, and December the 13th, all on Saturdays. These are all-day events. For those of you who want to go and really get out there, and the chiggers will be dead, the snakes will be down, the foliage will be down, and I'll tell you this, if it ain't raining, it ain't training. We're going anyway. So it'll be a lot of fun if we get out there and kick rocks and step over logs and kick pine cones and all the things that you do when you go out and study this campaign properly. The field trips I put on at 8. We know we'll start at 8, and if we finish at 16:30, if we finish at 4:30, fine. If it goes a little later, no complaint, because we're having a good time. We want to get out there and learn. Of course, as you know, in December, it's going to be dark around 1700, around 5 o'clock. Anyway, so we're going to have to wrap it up around 4:30. And we will leave from the parking lot right out front for these field trips. So these will be conducted as low profile as possible so we can get out in the woods. So the biggest vehicle we'll take is a van. We'll see how that's going to work out, depending on the site, the number of people who actually want to go and who qualify for this. All right, what are the requirements to do some of these things? All right, for your certificate, for your tour guide book, and to go on the field trips, you have to attend 9 of the 12 seminars. 9 of the 12, and we will keep attendance roster, so make sure when you come that you sign your attendance roster out front, so you get your credit, and you get your gold star put next to your name. 9 of the 12 sessions to get these. Now, you don't necessarily have to become a tour guide, but that's the requirement to get your certificate, your tour guide book, and to go on the field trips. For those of you who just want to come in occasionally, if the subject matter of that particular week interests you, fine, you're welcome to do it. Somebody says, I want to learn about Shiloh. I want to learn about the Battle of Iuka. Or the Bayou Expeditions. Boy, that's interesting. Don't miss the Bayou Expeditions. Because they've been short, scripted, and Grant's memoirs. But they are marvelous studies of some of the gutsiest moves I've ever seen. When you take a 51 and a half foot wide boat and run it down a 50 foot ditch, that's gutsy. Okay? This is our schedule. September 23rd, 2 weeks from now, I got a little artillery garage land. September 23rd, sessions 1 and 2, and you've got it there in front of you. September the 30th, it goes all the way through November the 4th. And then on Veterans Day, of all days, we'll have the written exam. And by November the 11th, you will be veterans. We'll make you veterans. And we'll have the exam on Tuesday night, November the 11th, for those of you who want to take the tour guide exam. And then if you want to take the tour guide exam, if you pass that, then the park will administer you an oral exam as you go through the park to get you your official tour guide official license and okay. So that's how that will work. Now, you are not going to be rich by being a licensed battlefield guide, as any of them can tell you. We've got several of you right now. You can see the rates. I've gotten that question from a number of folks. What are the rates? And you can see that if you don't live close by, it's not with the price of gas, it's not going to be cost effective for you to say drive from Macomb, Mississippi up here to conduct a tour
for $35.
You spent more than that gas getting up here and back. So be realistic about it. Just look at it. It's more a labor of love.
We're regulated
something like that, you have to have a commercial special use permit that you would have to, at the beginning of the year, and tell us, okay, this is what I want to do. I want to start my own business. And, you know, that's fine. There's no law against that. But you do have to, you know, notify us that you're going to do that. And then there's a fee that you have to pay, and it will be an annual fee in order for you to conduct that business here. And it may be more than what you may make on tour. I need to tell you that. But that's the regulation on that. That's a good question.
Any other points or questions? Yes, ma'am.
You had mentioned the perfect gates like Winston or tour up there. What they do is tour guide drives your car around. What kind of liability, and how does that work?
That's a good question too. I would not, and I know the guys here do it, all right. But you're on your own when you do something like that. You're not covered by the park. You're covered either by your insurance or that person's insurance. You don't necessarily have to drive that car for that.
Here's the short, tricky answer to that. Automobile insurance is not a federal regulation, it's a state regulation. And because of the nature of the visitors here, you might be in a Texas car in the morning. Next weekend, you might be in a Louisiana car. Every state's insurance laws are different, so their insurance coverages are different. What is common among all 50 states is that if you are using someone's car with their permission, you become an insured under their insurance policy. So the one question you want to ask is, do they have insurance? If they don't have insurance, you might want to give it a little thought, but there is a safety built in there. Your insurance also covers you if you have a personal automobile policy while you drive somebody else's car. So technically, even though you are not covered, since the park is a federal entity, it does not have an insurance policy. We rely on sovereign immunity. You have your personal auto insurance policy as Shield One. You also have the insurance policy of the car, the visitor's car that you're operating, as Shield Number Two.
In a prior life, Tim used to sell insurance.
If it was a New York insurance question, I could go much deeper, but it's not.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you be a passenger rather than a driver?
Yeah,
certainly. Absolutely. As a matter of fact, I much prefer talking as a passenger than I don't think it's my personal is I like someone else to drive if I'm talking, because it's hard to keep your eye out on the road at the same time. That's my personal thoughts, and I realize it's done in other ways. And there are times I've had people tell me out in the field or whatever they wanted me to drive, particularly if we're way back around Grand Gulf and those back roads down around Fort Gibson, they'll feel good about it. Well, I do need to drive back down there. But then I hunker down and I pay attention to what I'm doing and quit talking. But yes, passenger, absolutely. Yes.
How much responsibility does a tour guide have for the people in the vehicle? For instance, getting out and doing things that maybe they shouldn't, or...
Well, I mean, you will know the rules here. I mean, we really don't want people climbing on cannons. You know, there's some common sense things. Right. You know, don't go into the fire ant hole and things like that. You just have to warn people about that, because there'll be some people who are not around for you and don't know those things. But, you know... I always caution people when I'm out on tours, say, watch your step going up, you know, and you might have some, you know, we had a lady in here yesterday who we thought was having a heart attack. You may have things like, I mean, we've had someone have a heart attack on a bus here, and I can remember Mr. Webster, one of the tour guides here, had to deal with that, and, you know, it's good to, you'll have your cell phones with you, you should know our numbers. Park number, 911 works good, they get a hold of us, and we can respond to any emergencies that might arise. But that's another good question. Yes, sir.
What information is provided about guiding in the city? If you're both a guide in the park and a guide in the city, is these sessions cover the park? What qualifies one to be a guide in the city?
The tour guide manual is just chock full. Jeff has crammed more stuff in there about the city than you can stick at. It's neat.
And the second part of that, General, is if you complete the course and you take the test and you meet the requirements, then and you have to be approved by the Park Service on your oral exam, who qualifies you to do the same in the city?
That's a good question.
Historically, honestly, if you want to know the truth, nobody has in the past. Now, the way, and the reason being, we have just recently, within the last year, said that my name is David Banjo. I'm the president of the Guide Association for Rock Valley. The reason I'm saying that is we had so many people that wanted to go into the city. They wanted to be able to take a tour of the city. So we as a group of guides came up with information that you needed in order to be able to give a tour in the city. So in essence, what we're saying is we supply you with some information. But even then, and even when you get through with this course, you can always go and look up more information. You're always going to be asked questions you don't know. So what I'm saying is, we don't license you so much per se into the city, but we expect you to know enough to take somebody through the city and give them a tour.
Keep in mind that a city tour is a very personal thing, based on what the individual is interested in. Some people may want to see old homes. Some people may want to see the Beating Heart Candy Company. You just don't know. So you need just to be prepared to guide that. So it's very difficult, and so far there is no exam, formal exam, on the city portion of it. It's just a matter of having enough knowledge as to what's out there so that you're flexible enough to take people out there and show them the city of Vicksburg if they want to see it.
Parker, I'll go so far as to say the same thing with the park. As you well know,
yep.
There are people who come from all parts of the country, and they might be interested in a particular unit. And so some of the information that's gleaned by the Vicksburg Convention and Visitors Bureau is they find out where these people are from, and so you know that probably before you get here, you might know that they're from Illinois. Well, you might go through your brain and go, okay, Illinois, well, there's a whole bunch of stuff about Illinois here, since half of Grant's Army is from Illinois, so you can do that. Or, they might be from Texas. So you're going to key in on some of those kind of things. So you're going to personalize your tours for your clients, as I like to call them. So.
And you never know what will come of that. 4 or 5 years ago, I had an octogenarian, an elderly gentleman who took me out in the parking lot after a day or so, and he opened up the trunk of his car and pulled a sword out. And he said, "This belonged to my great-great-grandfather. You probably never heard of him. T.D. Yost." I said, "Well, David Yost was your great-great-grandfather?" He said, "Well, yeah, you've heard of him." I said, "Well, Yost Independent Bank." And I said, "Let me ask you something. How did those guys use cannon that they captured at Champion Hill on the 16th of May? And on the 18th of May, they're shooting them into Vicksburg. You don't learn how to fire cannons in 2 days." He said, "That's simple." He said, "They were cannoneers. They were artillerymen. They had a battery that was captured at Harper's Ferry by Stonewall Jackson in 1862. And when they got paroled, they had no guns, and so they became infantrymen. So the first chance that they got to get cannon, they used it." I said, "Okay, next question. What are your plans for that sword?" And after, I worked on him for 3 days, and then I worked on him for a year, and he donated the sword. It's now in display up there in Vicksburg, here in this visitor center. P.M.O. David, your sword is here. So you never know. As you're working these things, if you show, of course, I took him to both of the monuments, not only the Yost Independent Battery Monument, but the very small marker behind the Eleanor Memorial, where one section served. And I had a Union artillery guy on and photographed him in front of his great granddad. "Oh, you smooth the guy if you want his sword." So we smoothed him, we got his sword. So, and I just took him on a tour of Gettysburg a couple of months ago. He's still doing quite quite well. And he was like, grandson was getting married in Gettysburg. He says, when are you going to be up there? I told him. He said, you know what? I'll schedule the wedding around you being up there. And you take me to show me where my great-great-grandfather fought with a Pennsylvanian. So we took him through a lot. So you just never know how these things will work out. But it's a lot of fun, folks, when you can see the light bulb turn in somebody's eyes. And you say, aha, aha. It's come home. It's great. It's really rewarding.
General, if I can interject a second. You're not out there by yourself. Well, technically, yes, you are. But we've got resources here in the park that are open to you as guides. You are a contractor to the park. You're an independent contractor. We have a research library. Terry Winchell, our park historian, has been the park historian here at Vicksburg for 30 years. He's forgotten more about this park than I'll ever know. Myself and the other rangers that work here all have backgrounds in history. In fact, one of them is finishing his doctorate in history. So far, it's been kind of an upside-down relationship. The guides know more about Vicksburg than I do. I haven't been able to be a lot of help to them. They've been more help to me. But we've got resources. You will be asked a question that you can't answer. I remember I memorized every fact about the USS Cairo I could come across. I was standing out there with my Stetson all full of confidence, and a woman says, Ranger, can I ask you a question? I'm thinking, oh, can you ever? She goes, that stone monument over there, how tall is it? Well, ma'am, unlike the Washington Monument, which is 555 feet, 5 3/4 inch, that monument is, one moment, please, I've got that information at the desk. And I had to run in and look up. It's 202 feet, by the way, if you are asked. So you will, they've been playing stump the chump with me for a year, and I work here. So, but if you don't have an answer, you're going to end up here at the visitor center and say, you know what, rather than guess, let's wait till we get to the end of the tour, and I will look up that information. We've got computer databases, we have a library, but we will get you the answer, or we will take the people's name, phone number, email, whatever it takes to contact them, and Terry or I or someone else will look that information up, but we will get it to them. So you have a support network that's, you know, in my case, just questionable at best.
Yeah, there's no embarrassment about saying, you know, I give the email to
you. Did I send it to
you? You can't get it there. Because
don't confuse me.
I got asked last week when Eagle Bend became Eagle Lake, why is the island now called Australian Island? Of course, an Australian answered it. So I went back, I said, I'll give you an answer tomorrow. And I Googled it, and of course, it's not there. And then I studied the maps and it dawned on me. Because it formed an island that looks like Australia. That's the best answer I could give you. So I said, I'm going to give you the best answer I can. It's a big island, looks like Australia. And that is my take on it. But there may be another reason, another answer, but that's the best I can come up with. You just never know some of the crazy questions you get asked. Not crazy, but interesting. You know, they used to always tell us in the Army, there's no such thing as a stupid question. Well, I beg to differ. I actually had a soldier ask me if they used the Union Naval Monument for sharpshooting post during the siege. all right, now I finally got the stupid question. Okay, now I'm going to throw something out. This is not study. This is just for fun. I've got a question for you for the next session. And here it comes. What is the name of the ironclad gunboat whose hull was used as part of, don't answer this if you know the answer. What I want you to do is to write it down and email me, or if you don't email, snail mail me, and the first person who sends me the answer, I am going to send them and bring them to them at the next session this incredibly marvelous tome. This is a profound work written by one of the most astute authors I've ever run into. And if you win it, I will sign it for you. Yes, ma'am.
Back it up so I can finish the question.
Oh, wait. Here it comes. I'll bring it up for you one more time. What is the name of the ironclad gunboat whose hull was used as part of the foundation for a bridge over the Mississippi River?
You see the picture again, please?
Well, you want to see the picture again. All right. I'll show you the bridge.
Is that bridge still standing, or has it been removed?
If you give out the answers, you just gave away your book. Okay, so I'm not going to give you any more clues than what you got right there. And if you think you know it, email me. Email me or snail mail me, and I'll give you the address. Walker@paddlefocus.com, or if you are computer challenged, or Katrina got yours, and that's your story, and you're sticking to it, you're not going to replace it, or your dog ate it, then stale them in Clinton, Mississippi. And whoever gets it to me first, I will sign the book for you and bring it to you next time. And then we'll see how that goes, and we'll try to come up with something else for you next time.
Now, Jeff Gambrone don't count, right?
Say again?
Jeff Gambrone don't count.
Jeff Gambrone don't count. No, Jeff Gambrone. This contest is not eligible for employees of
Partner, can I ask him real quick?
Yeah.
Does anybody know? Okay.
I didn't think I knew. I thought this was so far in the weeds you'd have 40 chiggers on you by the time you dug it out.
It's gonna be.
This is deep in the weeds, okay? But it will be, I'll of course identify it to you at our next briefing on the 23rd, and I'll give you a little bit more detail and so forth. Okay. I saved this for the last, but I believe you have already beaten us to death with all your questions. But if you do have any more questions, let's have them. And if not, yes, sir.
Do the guides have the opportunity to get called on to take any of these people down to Brands Up or Fort Gibson or Fulton or any other places besides the battlefield here in Pittsburgh?
David?
Yes, they do. In our guide association, we have some guides that feel more comfortable taking people to those locations. And when they ask for those locations, we usually try to tailor that tour to that person that can do them the best tour. Because there are some people that just don't know enough about to give a good interpretation of the battles that happen outside the city of Vicksburg. So for that reason, we do try to cater to that person as much as possible. And that might mean that I get called to give that tour. They get here and they go, now I want to go see Grand Gulf, or I want to go do such and such. And we might have to say, let me call somebody else that can come here and can give you a better tour than I can give you. So
pretty much tailor these tours to what these people say they want.
Yes, sir. And 99% of them, don't get it wrong, 99% of them want this part and what you can give them. Every once in a while, you do get somebody that wants a little bit more, and that's
and they normally call ahead. It's normally not a spur-of-the-moment thing where they come here and say, I want to go to Grand Gulf. Normally, these folks know what they want to see, and I'm thinking of military groups, and you may not be comfortable doing a military tour, because a lot of times, if you don't speak the language, you know, you're not going to connect with folks like that. So, you may only want to do elder hostels or school groups or something like that, but we don't get a lot of requests unless it's way out there, like they're planning out 2 or 3 months, and normally it's a group that wants to do that. Go ahead, Dave.
I want to tell you that I don't want to scare anybody off of doing this. When you become a guide, you also do the city like we're talking about. We don't throw you out there to the wolves. You never go on a city tour without having gone a few times with somebody, one of the guys that has been in a city tour and gives a city tour. So you, in essence, are taking and mentoring underneath somebody and a few people, and then we'll probably send you out when you feel like you're comfortable to go out. We're not going to just send you into the city and say, we hope you learn something, or I hope you know something on your own. We're not going to do that. You will probably ride with a guide or two until you feel comfortable, and then you can say, I can do a city tour now.
And that's the same in the park.
And yes, in the park. A lot of times what we'll end up doing, before you take your oil with the ranger that you go out with, a lot of times, and they did that to me, and I did it with different ones and all like that, you, in essence, say, one of you would say, call me up and say, look, I want to do a tour. Can I go out with you? You'll ride with me, and maybe you feel like, okay, I'm ready to talk to Rick and do the tour. But you say, I want to give you a tour first. Can we do that? We can work around a lot of ways around you. We're not going to leave anybody just hanging out there by themselves. We're not going to do that at all. So feel comfortable with the idea that we're going to take care of you because we want you to give a good interpretation of the park to the people that you're going to be giving tours to.
The training that we're going to be giving you the next few weeks, we're going to cover infinitely more than the military park, as I showed you in the earlier slide, because it's infinite. This is the period at the end of a very long sentence, the park. The sentence is out there, and we're going to show you all that out there. Obviously, if you were somebody called you and wanted you to go to Grand Gulf or Port Gibson, that's not a two-hour tour. You know, that's 2 hours traveling down there and back. So it's an all-day affair. And it's a lot of fun if you get a chance to do that. Now, what I would encourage you to do, because this should be fun for you. It should be fun to learn and fun. And if you want to become a guide, great. It's not a high-stress thing. You shouldn't get all uptight about it. Nobody's going to put a mark on your permanent record if you fail the exam. You don't get any 40 lashes or anything like that. And so have fun with this, and I think you'll have a good time learning. Nothing else, if you don't want to become a guide, it's a good time, good opportunity to learn a lot about what we have and our resources we have out here for tourists. Nothing else, good cocktail party talk and a place to take your kids or your grandkids. I can't tell you how many times somebody will email me and say, I couldn't wait to show my grandchildren what you showed me the other day. I took my children. And that's a lot of fun. A lot of fun because, you know, when you get, the older you get, the smarter you want to, you want to appear. No other points or questions, and we'll see you on the 23rd.
Is there any reason we can't tape these things and record the session?
Audio tape? Audio tape is fine. No videos, please, but audio is fine. Okay. Audio is fine. We've got one video tape right here, but if you want to audio tape it, that's just absolutely fine.
Park, can we give you a question for the next game?
Throw one at
me. Okay. What was the name of the man out in the park that has a bust of relief or a portrait out in the park, who after the war was instrumental in helping build the bridge across the Yazoo River in Redwood?
Okay, the question was, the name of the man who was instrumental in building the bridge across the Yazoo River in Redwood. The bridge right up the, it's now got a new bridge being built right next to it. Okay.
The original bridge.
Say again?
It was the original bridge.
He's got a bust in the park. Okay, another one for us. That's a good one.
No, that's yours.
Well, that's mine. I share. Oh, but I'll work on that too. Okay. No other questions? Good night, folks. We'll see y'all next two weeks from the live.